Hello, I'm Mel Atkey. I'm the author of Broadway North and A Million Miles from Broadway, and I am a lecturer on all things musical theater. Operetta finally took root on English soil with the fourth collaboration between playwright William Schwenk Gilbert and composer Arthur Seymour Sullivan, the first theatrical songwriting team to receive equal credit for music and lyrics.
I'm called Little Buttercup, dear Little Buttercup, though I can never tell why, but still I'm called Buttercup, poor Little Buttercup, sweet Little Buttercup. Tickle your thighs. I've ribbons and laces to set off the faces of pretty young sweethearts and wives. Of treacle and toffee, of tea and of coffee, live eels that are ready to fry. And if you are courting, you soon may be sporting a top hat and tails and bow tie. Then buy of your buttercup, poor little buttercup, sailors should never be shy. Then buy of your buttercup, dear little buttercup, come of your buttercup, buy.
Gilbert aimed his barbed wit at virtually anybody of higher social status than himself when HMS Pinafore, or The Lass That Loved a Sailor, opened at London's Opera Comique, 25th of May, 1878.
I am the monarch of the sea, the ruler of the Queen's Navy, whose praise Great Britain will loudly chant.
And I am his sister,
I'm his cousin,
I'm his aunt.
And we are his sister and his cousin and his aunt,
his sister and his cousin and his aunt.
When at anchor here I ride, my bosom swells with pride, and I snap my fingers at foeman's taunt.
And so does his sister
and his cousin and his aunt.
And so does his sister and his cousin and his aunt.
His sister and his cousin and his aunt.
In fact, their partnership began rather inauspiciously 7 years earlier with Thespis, which ran for 63 performances at the Gaiety Theatre.
Discharged a function of the North, South, East, West, and Sex Junction. He was conspicuous, succeeding for his affable ways and his easy breeding. Although a chairman of directors, he was handling love with the ticket inspectors. He tipped the guards with brand new fibers and sang little songs to the engine drivers.
Only fragments of Sullivan's score survive from this early work. It took one more modest success, Trial by Jury, and one more failure, The Sorcerer, before that all-important breakthrough came.
As someday it may happen that a victim must be found, I've got a little list, I've got a little list of society offenders who might well be underground and who never would be missed, who never would be missed. There's the idiot denouncing with enthusiastic tone all football teams but his and every suburb but his own. The man who sits beside you on the plane and wants to talk, whose jabbering inspires you to jab him with your fork. Your auntie with the mustache who insists on being kissed. They'd none of them be missed. They'd none of them be missed.
He's got him on the list. He's got him on the list. And then none of them be missed.
This was not the beginning of musical comedy in Britain. That is usually dated to John Gay's The Beggar's Opera in 1728.
Where I laid on Greenland's coast, and in my arms embraced my lass, warm amidst eternal frost, who soon the half year's night would pass.
However, Gilbert and Sullivan created the first English works with original music to capture the imagination of the world. Many Americans, Alan J. Lerner and Ira Gershwin among them, cite Gilbert as a master lyricist, which of course he was. But his work was always quintessentially English. It is also of its time, yet much of its relevance today to a modern, non-British audience. Back in Vienna, The Merry Widow was originally offered to composer Richard Heuberger, who had enjoyed some success in 1898 with Opera Ball, but he failed to provide a satisfactory score. The commission was then offered to a young Hungarian musical director, Franz Lehár, who had already enjoyed some success with Weiner Frauen and Rustelbinder, both in 1901. The Merry Widow's success was immediate. A London production opened in 1907, and it soon spread across Europe and North America. Its influence on the later American musical is unmistakable. Listen to the Maxim's sequence. Then listen to the verse leading into Shall We Dance from The King and I.
We've just been introduced, I do not know you well, but when the music started, something drew me to your side. So many men and girls are in each other's arms, it made me think we might be similarly occupied. Shall we dance on a bright cloud of music? Shall we fly? Shall we dance? Shall we then say goodnight and mean goodbye? Or perchance, when the last little star has left the sky, shall we still be together with our arms around each other? And shall you be my new romance? On the clear understanding that this kind of thing can happen, shall we dance? Shall we dance? Shall we dance?
With some of the money he was now earning, Lehár bought a Baroque mansion in the suburb of Nussdorf that had once belonged to Emanuel Schikaneder. He was to be one of the few composers to stay behind and prosper under the Nazis. World War I adversely affected the Viennese operetta in two ways. During the war, nothing was exported to Britain or France. And after the war, the Habsburg Empire, and the glamour that went with it, was a distant memory. In a country that had thrown off its monarchy, people lost interest in stories about princes and counts. At the same time, New York was beginning to assert itself. Elegance and gentility were usurped by the rhythms of jazz. At this point, I feel that I should say something about this term operetta. It has been used to describe everything from Strauss to Ralph Benatsky and Vincent Scotto. The Oxford Concise Dictionary of Music defines it as little opera, strictly a play with overture, songs, entr'actes, and dances, but the term has become synonymous with light opera. Example, Offenbach's La Belle Hélène and Strauss's Die Fledermaus. And musical comedy, example, Coward's Bittersweet. I tend to compare it to terms like victrola and gramophone, which are simply archaic terms for a record player. According to Stephen Sondheim, opera implies endless stentorian singing, operetta implies gleeful choirs of peasants dancing in the town square, opera bouffe implies hilarious, in intent at least, complications of mistaken identity, musical comedy implies showbiz pizzazz and blindingly bright energy, musical play implies musical comedy that isn't funny. For me, an opera is something that is performed in an opera house in front of an opera audience. The ambiance, along with the audience's expectation, is what flavors the evening. Opera is defined by the eye and ear of the beholder. The world of the 19th century was not as clear-cut in separating classical versus popular as we are in the 21st century. Looking at it from a modern standpoint, works that are not performed in opera houses and that do not use operatic voice production would be classed as musicals. I will go further and say that a show that aims for a popular audience is a musical, as is one in which a libretto is of equal importance to the music. In the space of about 10 years after World War II, Vienna allowed the majority of its opera houses to be pulled down as part of what seems to have been a "let's destroy our cultural heritage" campaign. The fate of the bricks and mortar seems to echo that of the Viennese musical itself. What need would they have for theaters if the operetta is dead? For whatever reason, the generation of writers and composers who eventually followed after Kalman, Lehár, and Benátsky chose to largely ignore their examples and to follow instead the leads of American and British writers. Yet American composers such as Leonard Bernstein, Candide, and Stephen Sondheim, A Little Night Music, managed to create works that brought a late 20th century sensibility to the Viennese operetta form.
Sorrow, nothing can assuage.
Oh,
of being basely tearful. I'll show my noble stars by being bright and cheerful.
Come on.